Chapter 2. Alex Metcalf had a great fall. It was a day that would go down in baseball history, like Lou Gehrig replacing Wally Pipp or Cal Ripken Jr. replacing Mark Ballinger. Baseball fans all over the world would look back at the moment Alex Metcalf took over for the Tin Soldier as the beginning of his amazing career. Alex spun around with his arms in the air, making a ha sound like the crowd giving him a standing ovation. "What are you doing?" Dorothy asked. She stood next to him in a foul territory with her arms crossed. "I'm being the announcer, you know, building up the game." It had to have been a day like this 150 years ago that someone first picked up a bat and a ball and drew lines in the dirt like they had no other choice. Like the earth said, "Shut up and get in the dugout," Dorothy told him. "Aw, come on," Alex said. He followed her inside where the rest of the team waited for them. "Where's the awe, the magic?" "This isn't a game," Dorothy told him. "I need everybody to be serious and focused," she told her teammates. "We're going to win this one, right?" "Right," Button Bright said. But he was the only one of them who looked particularly convinced. Not the patchwork girl, not the robot, not the flying monkey. "Wait a minute," Alex said. "A flying monkey? The Cyclones? And your name is Dorothy. Is this like the Wizard of Oz or something?" "Well, at least I haven't been totally forgotten," Dorothy said. Toad rolled his eyes and nodded sympathetically. "Most of us are Oz characters, yeah," Dorothy explained, "but not all of us. There's me, I pitch. There's Scraps and Wright, the patchwork girl who was doing handstands, Jack Pumpkinhead at second, the pumpkin-headed scarecrow, Tick-Tock at catcher, the robot man, Button Bright in left, the blonde kid, and Pinkerton in center. Pinkerton was the flying monkey. We're all from Oz." Alex frowned. "I know you and the flying monkey, but I don't remember the others." Jack Pumpkinhead coughed uncomfortably. Scraps dropped back down to her feet. Even the machine man, Tick-Tock, managed to look unhappy. "We appear in a number of sequels," Tick-Tock said. His voice sounded like a music box, but his words came out like cubes from an ice dispenser. "The rest of the roster is filled out with ringers," Dorothy explained. "I get it," Alex said. "I play fantasy baseball." "Not like this you don't," Dorothy told him. "So, Toad, you met on the bus." Toad tipped his cap. "I do hope I can count on your vote in the upcoming elections, old bean. If you're around, then, of course." "Sure, yeah," Alex said, going with it. "And who are you supposed to be?" he asked to the rabbit. "The Easter Bunny? Peter Rabbit?" The rabbit choked on a long piece of grass he was chewing. "Peter Rabbit? That's Bear Rabbit," Dorothy said with a grin. "Brer Rabbit plays third, and Toad's a short." Bear Rabbit crossed his arms and grumbled, glaring at Alex. "Okay, so who are we playing?" Alex said. "Wizards on broomsticks?" "The Mother Goose team," Alex laughed. "Mother Goose? Excellent. My mom's been reading Mother Goose stuff to my little sister. So how good are they, like as a team?" "Fair to middling," Button Bright told him. "We might actually have a shot." "So how good are we?" "Oh, well," Dorothy said, "we're..." "Plumb awful," Brer Rabbit said. "Abominable," said Toad. "We're the worst team in the whole tournament," said Scraps. "I wouldn't say that," Dorothy argued. "No, it's great that you're bad," Alex told them. Everyone stared at him like he was crazy. "I'm serious, don't you see it? It's classic. A ragtag group of misfits comes together for the first time when a mysterious new player joins the team and leads them to victory." "This guy's a legend in his own mind," Brer Rabbit said. "I rather like him," said Toad. "Think of the headlines," Alex told them. "Worst to first, Cyclones tear the roof off the tournament. We'll be like the 91 Twins, the 69 Miracle Mets. It's a Cinderella story." "Cinderella plays for the Royals," Dorothy told him. "Aw, come on," said Alex. "Don't any of you guys ever read Matt Christopher books? You gotta believe. Who's with me?" Only Toad looked enthusiastic. "I love it. Voters like a winner, you know." The crowd in the stands cheered as the opposing team took the field. "Play ball," called a sputtering umpire. "I don't care what the story is, as long as we win," Dorothy told the team. "I want everybody focused out there. Got it? Pinkerton, grab a bat. You're up first." "Go get him, Pinky," Alex said. The flying monkey stopped and stared at him. "Pinkerton," Alex quickly corrected himself. "I mean, go get him, Pinkerton." The flying monkey shook his head and stepped out onto the field. "Wow," Alex said. "Tough crowd." "Take heart, old man," Toad said, joining him at the dugout rail. "The rest of them just don't see the romance in the dark horse like you and me. We'll make them believers, just like I've done in my campaign for Prime Minister of Ever After. I used to be dead last in the polling, you know, but I've climbed to 9th place. Ever after? Alex asked. Before Toad could explain, Pinkerton slapped a base hit to left, flapped his wings, and soared to first base. He can fly, Alex cried. I mean, really fly. Well, he is a flying monkey, old man. Toad grabbed a bat. Now it's time for me to do some damage. To who, us or them? Br'er Rabbit asked. Just you wait, Toad told Alex with a wink. Old Toadie will drive him in. Marvelous Toad, wonderful Toad, the greatest batsman any storybook has ever seen. Toad strode to the plate, taking impressive-looking practice swings as he walked. Dorothy and Button Bright came up to the rail to watch with Alex. Looks like we're in business, Alex told them. You've never read The Wind in the Willows, have you? Button Bright asked. The pitcher went into her windup and pitched, and Toad flailed at it for strike one. If Alex didn't know better, he'd have sworn Toad had his eyes closed. The amphibian's second try was worse. Toad lost his handle on his bat mid-swing and ended up around first base. So, what can you tell me about the competition? Alex asked the others, too embarrassed to watch Toad. Like Jack Horner at the hot corner is pretty good, Dorothy told him. So's the pitcher, Mary Mary. She'll knock your head off with a fastball if you crowd the plate. As it to prove her point, the pitcher made Toad hit the dirt with the ball at his head. Mary Mary quite contrary, Alex said. Got it. Watch out for the catcher. She's the girl with the curl in the middle of her forehead. When she's good, she's very, very good. But when she's bad, you know the rest. The 4-6-3 combination, the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker, they're right. They're tight. The outfield's weak, though. You can run on them if you hit a gapper. Jack and Joe right and left take a lot of falls, and Humpty Dumpty's in the center doesn't like to go near the wall. Humpty Dumpty, you gotta be kidding. Sure enough, a large round egg wearing a baby blue uniform of the Mother Goose squad patted his glove in center. I hope I remember half of this when I wake up, Alex said. Toad struck out swinging, and Dorothy grabbed a bat. I hit next, then you, then Br'er Rabbit, if you're as good as you say. Just don't hit into a double play, Alex told her. I want there to be base runners, so my first at bat will be legendary. Dorothy shook her head again and said nothing to Toad as he passed her on the way back to the dugout. I say, watch out for that bowler, Toad told the family. She's awfully good. You make every pitcher look good, Br'er Rabbit told him. Alex watched Dorothy dig in at home, then wrap the first pitch she saw into the gap. When the dust cleared, Dorothy stood on second, and the flying monkey was clutching third. Perfect. Two ducks on the pond, Alex said. Jack Pumpkin had leaned over to TikTok. Nobody said anything about ducks when they told me the rules. Now batting, the announcer boomed, Cyclones first baseman, Alex Metcalf. Scattered applause greeted him as he stepped out onto the field. It wasn't exactly the ha he had imagined, but he'd shown them. Pretty soon, everybody would know the name Alex Metcalf. You gonna stand there all day, the umpire called. Sorry, sir, Alex froze. The umpire was a goat. A goat wearing a black umpire's mask and chest pad. The other two umpires on the field were goats, too. Alex shook his head and stepped into the batter's box. This wasn't bad burrito territory. It was a Halloween night, horror movie marathon, too much candy, kind of crazy dream. Mary Mary put a fastball over the plate while he was daydreaming. Strike one, called the goat. Hey, wait a minute, I wasn't ready. Alex blinked and tried to get ready for the next pitch, but it was on top of him before he could think. He took an excuse me swing and missed. Strike two, the billy goat bleated. Over at first, Dorothy shook her head like he had already struck out. On the mound, Mary Mary was nodding at the catcher's next sign, ready to put him away. Time out, Alex called. Time out. The home plate goat threw up his hooves, and Mary Mary stopped mid-throw to glare at Alex. He took a few steps away from the batter's box and tried to get a grip. What kind of dream was this anyway? He hoped it wasn't one of those bad ones where he swung and swung and swung at pitches and never connected. Batter up, the goat called. Alex took a deep breath and stepped back in. I don't care what kind of dream this is supposed to be, he decided. I'll make it great. Mary Mary got her sign. She went into her windup. Alex hitched his bat and hit the deck as the ball came screaming for his head and sent him falling to the dirt. Ball one, the umpire said. You think? Alex asked. He got up and dusted himself off. The catcher laughed. Mary doesn't like it when hitters step out on her. Oh, yeah? Well, she's going to like what I do next even less. Mary came at him again with a fastball, but this time Alex was ready. He wiped the smile off her face with a towering drive that soared high and deep over the left fielder and into the bleachers for a home run. Now the crowd did go, ha! And Alex flipped his bat away and broke into the home run trot he'd practiced over and over again in his backyard. He put his hands up and spun like he'd just won the World Series, basking in the cheers of 30,000 fans. He would never have hot-dogged it in a real game, of course. Showboating like that would have gotten him benched by his coach in a heartbeat. But this was just a dream. It didn't matter what he did here. He was waving to the crowd with his back to third base when he heard a zap and a pow and a boom, and the ha turned into screams. Were they shooting off fireworks? An enormous howl shook the stadium. It had to be something they were playing over the loudspeakers, but Alex couldn't figure out why. The baker at second called out, "No, no," to Alex with a horrified look on his face, but Alex just laughed. If the baker can't take the heat, he should stay out of the oof. Alex backed into someone and they both went sprawling. The screaming crowd gasped, then fell silent. Dang, had he hit Dorothy? If he'd run into her, they would both be out. But it wasn't Dorothy. Standing around third base, there, three new people. A gray-bearded old wizard, a pudgy woman with tiny fairy wings on her back, and a weirdly an ordinary-looking little boy in a blue hoodie. On the ground at their feet was the thing Alex had run into, an enormous wolf. Oh, hey, sorry, Alex said. I didn't think anybody would be behind me. The wolf stirred, and Alex offered a hand to help him up. It was as though time stopped in the stadium for everyone but Alex. He could hear the blood pumping in his ears, and he felt his muscles twitch as he held out his arm, but everyone else was frozen in place, holding their breath, while the wolf stared at him. It felt like a lifetime went by, and then someone laughed. It was just a giggle from somewhere up in the stands, but it opened the floodgates. Soon everyone in the stadium was laughing, the way everyone always applauded when somebody dropped a tray in the cafeteria. The laughter shattered the ice that held Alex. The wolf and the wizard's in place, and the wolf roared and started to grow bigger. Really bigger, like nightmare bigger. Alex took a step back, and the laughing in the stands turned to screams as the fans started to flee. The wolf bared his big teeth and leapt at Alex, but the fairy flicked her wand. The wizard muttered an incantation, or a spell, and the boy closed his eyes and squinted. A purple mist grabbed the wolf in midair and stopped him inches away from Alex's face. The wolf yowled, fighting and clawing to break free of whatever the three were doing to him, but he was trapped. Back to the Black Forest with the wolf, the wizard said. No, no, the wolf howled. I was finally free. He huffed and puffed, and he tried to blow the three magicians down, but all he managed to do was spin around in the purple mist. I'll get you for this. I'll get you, he cried. The audience had stopped running for the exits when the wizards attacked, and now they cheered. The little boy came over and calmly shook Alex's hand. Thank you for your assistance, he said. He sounded older than he looked. The big bad wolf just escaped from his prison, and we've been pursuing him all over town. No doubt he came here to make it harder for us to fight him. All these innocent people around, you know. Sure. I didn't know I was helping. The wolf's eyes found Alex's and stayed on him. He sniffed at the air. You did this to me, the wolf said. What's your name? Alex, he said without thinking. Alex Metcalf. Let us away, Charles Wallace, the old wizard said. And he and the fairy woman dragged the wolf along, still trapped in their magic. The little boy started to follow them, then turned back to Alex. You probably shouldn't have told him your name, he said, but thanks again. The three left with their prisoner, and Alex stood on the base between the second and third, not exactly sure what had just happened. Everyone else seemed baffled too. The huge crowd, the Cyclones, the Mother Goose team, they all stared at him, waiting to see what he would do next. Alex shrugged. So, are we going to finish this game or what?